floor is yours.
Introduction. Good morning and hello to everyone. In this talk, I'd like to present some results obtained in collaboration with Alessandra Celletti and related to the dynamics of space debris in one-to-one and two-to-one resonances. The overview of my talk is the following. After a short introduction, I will present the equations of motion in Cartesian coordinates. Then I will switch to the Hamiltonian formulation, where I will present the geopotential and resonances. And then finally, I will present some results and draw some conclusions. Following a two-line element catalog, more than 22,000 objects larger than 10 centimeters are orbiting around the Earth, but just 6% of them are operative satellites. The number of objects increase exponentially if we count smaller objects. Down to 1 centimeter, we have 500,000, and down to 1 millimeter, we have a very huge number of fragments. In fact, the spatial density of objects as a function of altitude can be seen in this plot, where we recognize here the main regions, the LEO, MEO, and GEO regions. Understanding the overall evolution of satellites in space debris is essential for maintenance and control strategies, as well as for space debris mitigation. A large number of works are dedicated to study the dynamic of space debris, in particular the resonance effects on MEO and GEO orbits. And here are listed some of some of the paper dealing with this subject. The aim of the talk is the following: to present a description of the dynamics of space debris in one-to-one and two-to-one resonances, and this analysis includes an explanation of the main dynamical features of each resonance, a cartographic study of the one-to-one and two-to-one resonances by using the Fassier-Poonv indicator, and a description of the role of zonal harmonics, tesseral harmonics, and their interaction in the long-term predictability of MEO and GEO orbits. Now, let's see the equations first in Cartesian coordinates. The Keplerian motion of a satellite or space debris is perturbed by the oblateness of the Earth, rotation of the Earth, Sun, Moon, and other non-gravitational forces like solar radiation pressure or atmospheric drag if the body reaches the LEO region. We refer the motion to a fixed quasi-inertial reference system where the XY plane is the equatorial plane. And we will use another frame, a synodic one, rotating with the Earth. Clearly, theta is the sidereal time. The motion is described by this vectorial differential equation, where V stands for the Earth's gravitational potential, and the other terms are the contribution due to the Sun, Moon, and solar radiation pressure. In terms of spherical harmonics, the Earth's gravity potential can be expanded in this form, where by n we mean the degree of harmonic, m is the order of the harmonic. If m is zero, we speak about zonal harmonics, and otherwise we speak about the tesseral harmonics. P are the Legendre polynomials, and j are the coefficients of harmonics. If we are interested in propagating a very accurate orbit, then we should take a large number of terms in this expansion. However, if we are dealing with resonances, if we are interested to catch the main dynamical features of one-to-one and two-to-one resonances, and it is enough to consider this expansion up to degree 3, and we will see later this. Here in this plot, we have the order of magnitude of various perturbations of a function of distance from the center of the Earth, where GM stands for the attraction of the gravity of the spherical Earth, and then we have the perturbations by the harmonics J2, J22, and so on, Sun, Moon, and solar radiation pressure with different coefficients for area to mass ratio, and also the atmospheric drag. We numerically integrated the above system of equations, referred hereafter by this relation, and we computed the fast Lyapunov indicator. We used for propagation predictor-corrector Adams method. I will present the results a little bit later. Now let's see the Hamiltonian formulation. In terms of the Delaunay variables, which are related to the orbital elements by these relations, the Hamiltonian can be written in this form, where we have here the disturbing function due to the Earth, due to the Moon, Sun, and solar radiation pressure. And of course, the canonical equations can be written in this form. We focus our attention on the disturbing function due to the Earth, for which we can use this expansion, where F are the inclination functions, G are the eccentricity functions, and S are functions defined in this form, where by psi we denote the argument of the harmonics. The disturbing function due to the Earth contains secular terms, which are independent of the mean anomaly, short periodic terms, and the resonant terms. And clearly the long-term variation of the orbital elements is due to the secular part and the resonant part of the perturbing function. What do we mean by a gravitational resonance, called also tessellar resonance? We say that tessellar resonance occurs when there is a commensurability between the orbital period of the object and the period of the Earth's rotation. Namely, we have a relation of this form. And using the Kepler-Third's law, we can compute the location of each main resonances. And in this table, with the red, we have the 1-to-1 and 2-to-1 resonances. It is important to stress that since the frequencies of the argument of perigee and the longitude of the ascending node are not zero, each resonance splits into a multiplet of resonances, and the location of resonance for each component of the multiplet is obtained by using this exact relation. We consider the Earth's gravitational potential up to degree and order 4, and following an averaging process, we approximate the disturbing function due to the Earth by its secular part and resonant part. Up to second order in eccentricity, the secular part has this form, where the most important contribution is due to the J2. As regards the resonant parts, in the case of the 1-to-1 resonance, we found in the same conditions 20 terms, and here are listed 3 of them. And since we have to compare different terms, we introduced this heuristic definition, and we will say that given term, specific term, let's say the first one in black, is dominant in a given region of a space if its magnitude is greater than the magnitude of any other term of the expansion in that region of the phase space. Following this definition, we computed the plot of the dominant terms in black here as a function of eccentricity and inclination, and in black is the first term, with in brown we see is the region where the second term dominates, and in yellow, the third term. And from this plot, it is clear that the first term is dominating in almost all region of the phase space. Moreover, it's not dominant just in the sense of our definition. Detailed analysis can show that its magnitude is much larger than the magnitude of any other term, at least for small eccentricities and inclinations. In the case of 2-to-1 resonance, in the same condition, we find 10 terms. 3 of them are the most important ones, and are written here. And we computed also the dominant terms in the case of 2-to-1 resonance. We see here that we do not have a prominent term like in the case of 1-to-1 resonance, but we have three terms dominating in specific regions of the phase space. Moreover, in many regions of the phase space, they are comparable in magnitude, so the dynamics, it is much, much complicated in the case of 2-to-1 resonance than in the case of the 1-to-1 resonance. Now let's proceed to see some results obtained by using the Fast-Lyapunov indicator, and we will start with 1-to-1 resonance. I'd like to recall that the Magno indicator has been used in some papers to analyze the dynamics of the geospace debris. Here, in the case of 1-to-1 resonance, I'd like to point out just the role of higher degree harmonic terms. In these plots, we represent the Fast-Lyapunov indicator as a function of stroboscopic mean node, lambda, and the semi-measure axis. On the left, we computed the Fast-Lyapunov indicator, taking into account the aspect perturbations, just J2 and J22. So we get some pendulum-like plots with the libration regions in blue and in purple circulation regions. And these two kind of regimes are separated by this yellow curve, the separatrix. When we take into account the degree of our higher order degrees, higher degree harmonics up to order 3, then near the separatrix we see some additional yellow curves, and also the vibration regions are not symmetric anymore. What we see here in the left, it can be seen as a mirror reflection of the pattern shown on the right. This show that in the case, if we consider degree harmonics up to degree 3, then we get some more complex orbits. But what's happening if we take degree harmonics of the degree 4? And we see, comparing these plots from the left, obtained by taking the n equal to 3 and here n equal to 4, we see that they are almost identical. So we can conclude that the harmonics of order 4 play a negligible role. We validated our results obtained in Hamiltonian formulation by integrating the full equations of motion in Cartesian coordinates. And here we have some plots obtained by taking into account different perturbations. And we can conclude that in the case of 1-to-1 resonance, at least for small eccentricities and inclinations, the black term, which you saw earlier, is dominant in almost all is dominant, and the yellow regions which appear close to separatrix are due to the harmonics of order 3. Now let's see what's happening in the case of 2-to-1 resonance, which is much more complex. First of all, I'd like to describe a phenomenon which is called superposition of tesseract resonances. We consider this toy model, a very simplified model, which can reproduce the main dynamical features of the 2-to-1 resonance. We consider the secular part, and the secular part just the effect of J2, and these three terms which are dominant in some region of the phase space. Please notice that T1 and T2 are of order J22, and T3 is of order J32. Also, please notice the arguments of these harmonics, sigma plus omega, sigma minus omega, and sigma, where sigma is the resonant angle. Now, I'd like to recall the main effect of J2. So, setting these three terms to be zero in this Hamiltonian, we get that these frequencies are given by these relations, the frequency of the longitude of ascending node and the argument of perigee are given by these relations. And we remark that for inclination equal to the critical inclination, 64 degrees, then this parenthesis is vanishing, so omega is a constant. We are dealing with frozen orbits. But if the inclination is different from the critical inclination, then omega dot is different from zero, so each of the angles will have zero derivatives at different locations. So the gravitational resonance splits into a triplet of resonances, the separation between them being of order of few kilometers, depends on the inclination and eccentricity. To see the effect of this splitting, let's consider some plots obtained for eccentricity 0.1 and inclination 20 degrees in a region where all these three terms are comparable, T1, T2, T3 are comparable in magnitude. If we take into account the perturbation J2 and T1, we get a pendulum-like plot. The same if we take J2 plus T2, but please remark that we have a shift in semi-measured axis and also a pendulum-like plot in the case of J2 plus T3. But when we get, we take the whole model, J2 plus all these three terms, we get a very complicated shape and giving rise that we obtain a very complex behavior with regular and chaotic regions. In the next slide, we validated this result obtained by this toy model by integrating the Hamiltonian equations by considering the mass perturbations, the harmonics up to degree 4. And here on the bottom, we validated these results by integrating the Cartesian equations. So in conclusion, we can say that in the case of 2-to-1 resonance, as long as one of these three terms is dominant in a region of the phase space and the other two are small in magnitude comparatively with the dominant term, then we have a pendulum-like plot. Otherwise, if there are at least two terms which are comparable in magnitude, then we get a very complicated dynamics. There is an exception, and this holds for a critical inclination. In this case, even we have multiple terms which are comparable in magnitude, then we get a pendulum-like plot because each component of the multiplet gives the position of equilibria for each component of the multiplet is located at the same altitude. Another phenomenon which takes place in the case of 2-to-1 resonance is transcritical bifurcation phenomenon, which takes place for small eccentricities and for the inclination equal to 70 degrees. Here we have this plot of the dominant terms, and here we see this point, which is in fact a transcritical bifurcation point. What do you have? In fact, for inclination smaller than 70 degrees, here in this plot in the left, we have inclination equal to 50 degrees. We have this pendulum-like plot with some elliptic points and hyperbolic points. At the 70 degrees, these points, Dickey's equilibrium points, annihilate each other. And for inclination bigger than 70 degrees, the equilibria, the stable equilibria became unstable, and the unstable ones became stable. So this happens in the case of small eccentricities for inclination equal to 70 degrees. And to have a hint of what's happening for each inclination and for small, moderate, and big eccentricities, we computed here the fast Lyapunov indicator as a function of inclination and cinema measure axis. Here we have some plots obtained for small eccentricities. Here, please notice the at 70 degrees. Please notice the bifurcation point. We have also, we can have a hint of the amplitude of the resonance at given eccentricity. Here we have some plots. Here we have some plots for eccentricity equal to 0.1. Okay, so I'll finish this presentation. You can see some conclusion here and perspectives. Thank you for your attention.
Someone have a question.
Do we have any short question, a very short one for the speaker? Otherwise, I would encourage you to get in touch offline with the speaker. Okay, thank you for your
time. Yeah, I was waiting to see if anyone had a question.
Thank the speaker again.
Thank you very much.